Good morning, everybody. We gather on this, the second Sunday in Advent. It feels like forever since I've been with you as you. I was away 3 Sundays in November, not partying, I have to tell you, training and retreating and preaching elsewhere. So it's really nice to be back at Durban North and sharing in this service. Just a moment while I greet those who are online and to say sorry that we can't stream when I'm not here, but here is today's service and you are welcome too. To those who have been away for a bit and are back, nice to have you at home. To those who are visiting, you are welcome. We are all here on this second Sunday of Advent. We're going to light our Advent candle. I'm not sure that those of you on that side can see it. We might need to move it for next week, or move me or something. This week is we light the hope candle. And so we light, last week was hope, sorry, this week is peace. We're going to sing 2 verses of our Advent candle hymn as I light the candles. Be seated. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus, that you are here. You are in this moment, in this place with us. We see you in the faces of each other. Today, we're so glad to see you in the faces of children and friends, and church family. We pray for the gift of peace that comes from knowing you are here. Amen. I'm really battling to see today. It's very hot. So as soon as I put my glasses on, they mist up. I can't read my notes. And if I can't read my notes, I don't know what to say. So I'm really having a battle. So it could be an interesting service. Today, we especially asked our children to come because we miss them. COVID has taken our children's spaces. And so we're really glad to have little people around. Children, do you want to say hi? Hi. You don't have to. Hello, everybody. It's nice to have those who are younger than 13 with us. Hello, Tin Lee. Nice to see you. As we journey through Advent today, we wanted the children to be here, but we haven't had a chance to practice a nativity play like we would normally do or anything like that. So the children are just going to help me lead the prayers, some of the songs, and then they're going to go upstairs and have a little time together and a party while we reflect on the scriptures, and they'll come back for communion so that we can all be together. So that's what's happening today. Next week, our service will be shaped around a blue Christmas. A blue Christmas service recognizes that Christmas is not always all jolly and happy and comfortable and easy. There is also loss and missing people and worrying about things. And so we will hold all of those mixed feelings and our losses and our missing in our service next week. And then on the 19th in the morning, the choir will lead us in a service of readings and singing. And then in the evening, rain and COVID allowing, our plan is to go and have a picnic in the Graham Place Park. Graham Place Park is on the corner of Graham Place and Balgowney Roads, and we can help with directions. The idea is that your family or your couple or you come along with a little picnic and your chairs if you've got. We'll try and make a plan to help out with picnic chairs if you haven't got. We'll share. Come down to the park and we'll have a picnic first, late afternoon, 4:30. Then we'll do some carol singing, and we've invited the community, people who live around, to come and sing carols with us. We'll be outside. We'll be far from each other, hopefully. And our plan is for us as Durban North Methodists to bring along some shortbread and mince pies. The idea being you bring for you and to share with someone who's not from our church. Does that make sense? So if there's three of you coming, bring for six people, and then we'll just be able to share with everyone that's there. Instead of setting up a table and trying to cater, we will bring along and share something sweet after our picnics and our singing. And I will put it on our WhatsApp group later, but the theme that I'm kind of shaping the service around is what I love about Christmas is. And I've asked friends of mine on Facebook to tell me what they love, and I'd love to hear from you. What do you love about Christmas? I love the traditions. I love that I know how I'm going to celebrate, that it's a sense of security in a very changing world. So that is the 19th. The 25th, Christmas Day, we will have a 9:00 service here. If you really want to be earlier, I'll be at Greenwood Park at 7:30. So if you're an early bird and you're heading off somewhere, 7:30, Greenwood Park, 9:00 here. Then on the 26th, which is a Sunday, we won't do a full service, but we will share in morning prayer together. So I'll be here, I'll lead morning prayer, but it'll be a gentler time. It won't be a full service, it will be a prayerful time. The 31st, the plan is that we'll open up the church on the last day of the year. Again, not a service where I lead everything, but really a space for you to come in. I'll give you some guidance. So there'll be a piece of paper with some thoughts for praying. You can sit in your pew, spend some time in prayer and reflection, and I'll have communion available. So when you're ready, you can come and get communion. So basically between 4:30 and 6:00 on that 31st, come in when you're ready, spend some time in prayer, go when you're ready, end this year with God. I think that's all I've got from notice aside from me. No, it's not. We are wanting to bless two different communities this Christmas. The one is the children, and for the life of me, the name of the creche has gone out of my head. Kabazela. Madeline is wanting to send along some chips and sweets and nice party stuff. And the other community we want to bless, usually we go carol singing on Christmas Eve in old age homes, retirement centers, frail cares. We can't do that this year. So we'd like to send care packages, and we're hoping to send some nice toiletries, you know, some stuff that you can't get if you're on a budget, something nice for people. What I'm suggesting is if you can and want to bring a donation, fantastic. Hope my stewards aren't going to kill me after the service. If I don't come next week, you know I'm in big trouble. But I'm suggesting we take our retiring offertory, which is for the poor fund, after this service today and use it to top up those givings. Is everyone okay with that? So we take up a retiring offertory after communion today for the packages for Bill Buchanan residents and for the Kabazela children so that we can top it up. Stewards, am I in trouble? Okay, we'll talk afterwards. It's always easier to apologize than ask permission. No, I think we're good. So those two things. And then Peter, on behalf of the stewards, has a notice.
Good morning, everybody. We're on looking to Christmas and sharing the Christmas time. So dear members, we'd like to make an appeal to you, as we did the same time last year, for the generosity and the congregation, which they gratefully gave, the ongoing giving, which has sustained us through another very difficult year, and we're very aware of it, all of us. By the grace of God and your generosity, we have been able to meet our obligations. However, as you know, our budget has been very tight and there has been no room for extras, including bonuses for our hardworking staff. We therefore appealing to our congregation that if you feel so led, you might make an extra donation daily to the staff. The staff bonuses, which you can write in an envelope, and we've got a bag, which will be at the back of the church after the service or for the next couple of services. And if we could all put it into the bank account, whichever you find more easily, and then we can give this to the staff, that is those of Leanne and Bungay and KG, who have been working throughout the year, even when church has been closed and COVID has been up, had its way with us. So if we would like to do that, you can also leave something at the office, and we would be grateful for these little donations or big donations, just as you feel, for these members that have been hardworking through the last year. Thank you very much.
For me, it's not Advent until we sing this hymn. Hymn number 85, if you're in a hymn book. 85, if you're on the screen, it's there. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. This, for me, is the quintessential Advent hymn. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
seated, everybody. And I wonder if the children don't want to come and join me at the front. We'll squish in the front again, I'm afraid. I couldn't figure out another way to do it. And I'm, come Charlie, you know me. You're not scared of me, I don't think. Come and find a seat. I need a little bit of space at the front, yeah? So let's make some space. I'm trying to get my voice up so that the grown-ups can hear. It's fine. We're streaming for everybody, so I do want them to kind of be able to hear. Right. Have we got some space? Kerwin and Cullen. Let's move this back a bit. I'll just use my big voice, okay, grown-ups? The grown-ups have to behave. Usually the children are told, sit still. But this time the grown-ups have to sit still, okay? Do you think your moms and dads and grandpas and grannies can just let us have a moment? Hey, I haven't had so many children at the front for so long. I missed you guys. Are you all okay? Is everyone finished school yet, or you still got some school to go? You finished school. It's going to be a long holiday, hey? Who's got holiday? You got a bit of more school, Bex? Next week. And have you finished school, Colin? No, so some. Yes. I always make sure. So I've got a story for us. So I thought we could tell the story, and then we could help the grown-ups say some prayers. Do you think we can do that? And then we're going to sing some songs that I hope you know. Okay. So here is my story up here. I wonder if you've ever seen anything that looks like this. Have you seen something like this? Anyone got one like this at home? No. Some people have something like this at home. But then what they do is they say to the children, you mustn't touch because it can break. And so the children aren't allowed to touch, but this one you can play with. This one is made for you, and you can play with it any time you like. So are you ready for a story? Okay. This story is called The Holy Family. Here is the Christ child. Can you see? With his arms wide open to give you a hug. Here is the Mother Mary. And here is the Father Joseph. Okay. Let's just wait. We don't want to. I'm sure my voice is big enough, guys. Okay, I'll have to. Okay, we're going to have to get ready again. Let's get ready again, because we want to be listening with our hearts. So here is the Christ child with his arms wide open to give you a hug. And here is the Mother Mary. Here is the Father Joseph. Here is the donkey that the Mother Mary rode on when they went to Bethlehem to be counted by the soldiers. Mary was about to have a baby. And when you're almost ready to have a baby, it's hard to walk, right? So she would climb up on the donkey and ride. But when you're just about to have a baby, sometimes it's hard to ride on a donkey. So she would climb down and walk. This is the cow. She was surprised to find a baby where her breakfast should have been. This is a shepherd. There were many shepherds out in the fields that night, but we just got one, and he'll help us remember. And here is a sheep. There were lots and lots of sheep. This one will help us remember. They were out in the fields, and it was dark. And all of a sudden, there was a bright light in the sky, and they were afraid. They were even more afraid when they heard singing and voices saying, don't be afraid, peace on earth, goodwill to all people. Go to Bethlehem And there you will find a baby that will change everything. And so they hurried down to Bethlehem, and they found the baby as the angel said it would be. These are the three kings, the three wise men, the magi. They were very clever. They knew a lot about a lot of things. People thought they were magic, and that's where we get our word magic from. But the thing they knew the most about was the stars. And they saw a wild star up in the sky, and they followed it to the place where the baby was. And they gave him gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. The baby grew up to be a man. And he died on the cross, which is very sad, but also wonderful in an Easter kind of way. Because now he's in every town and in every place, reaching out to give the whole world a hug. So now I wonder what part of the story you like best. What do you like best?
I like when the kings are walking far away from the people.
So the kings came from far away to see baby Jesus, eh? A long, long way. The magi, the kings. I wonder what you like best. What do you like, Tony?
The cow.
The cow. She was surprised to find a baby where her breakfast should have been. I would be surprised too. What do you like?
I like when Angel Gabriel tried to ship it where Joseph was.
The angels told them where to go. Go look in Bethlehem, you'll find a baby who will change everything.
And then you bow down to
them. Did? They worshipped, eh? I wonder what you like. I wonder what you like best. If one sees what they want to say, what do you like? Anything you like? You like the kings, you like this king. They bought gold and frankincense and myrrh. Some more, yes.
Well, when Angel Gabriel tried to follow the angels, Angel Gabriel wanted to tell them.
Angel Gabriel wanted to be the one who brought the message, you think? Ooh, I wonder. I wonder what part of the story you think is the most important. What's the most important part of the story? Grown-ups, you can be wondering too. I wonder what is the most important part of the story.
It's about Mary and Joseph are trying to find a baby where the innkeepers were.
So they were trying to find a place to have their baby, and there wasn't any space in the inn. So they went and they were in the stable where the cow was. And was surprised. You think that's the most important part? I wonder what's most important. Here's a good question. I wonder if we could leave out anything and still have all the story we need. I've got an idea. Why don't we take out the shepherds? Do you think that's okay? No. You think it's okay? We don't need the shepherds. But Becca is saying maybe not. What do you think, Becca? Don't leave out the shepherds. You think you like them in the story? You think they might have something to tell us? I know. Let's leave out the donkey. No, why not?
I will leave the king.
How will it lead the king?
One king.
Okay. I wonder, was this the donkey that Mary rode, or was this the donkey that the king rode? I wonder. I wonder which part of the story God wants to give you this Christmas. I wonder which part is for you. I know that family here, you're having a baby. Hey.
maybe the baby's part of your story this Christmas. Whoops. I wonder which part of the story is for you. You don't have to tell me. You can carry on wondering. Let me put the story back up here, shall I? So here's the Christ child with his arms open to give you a hug. Mother Mary, with Mother Mary and Father Joseph. And the donkey that carried Mother Mary because she was about to have a baby. And the cow who was surprised to find a baby where her breakfast should have been. And the shepherds and the sheep. And the three kings, the three magi, they knew so much about a lot of things. And the risen Christ reaching out to give us all a hug.
That was Angel Gabriel.
You think that was I wonder. Do you think that's Angel Gabriel? I wonder. Hmm.
She done this to the shepherds, and she said, greetings.
It sounds to me that maybe you've been telling the story somewhere at school. Is that right? Awesome. That's fantastic. Now, I need your help, guys. I want us all to pray, but I thought we could say thank you to God for things that make us happy. So do you guys want to tell me what makes you happy this Christmas? What do you want to say thank you for? What makes you happy, Rach? The presents make you happy. I think that would make me happy too. Yes, good job. You like the Christmas tree. So we're going to say thank you for Christmas trees. What else makes us happy this Christmas?
It's about that I like a lot of presents.
You like a lot of presents. I wonder. I think your mom and dad and Father Christmas I wonder, eh? A lot of presents. Well, okay.
I like chocolate.
I like you've forgotten what you were going to say. I'll come back to you. Charlie, what do you like about Christmas? Oh, these children all like presents. Tilly? What makes you happy?
I like
St. Nicholas. There's a lovely Christmas. There's a lovely story about St. Nicholas. Maybe I'll tell that one on Christmas Day, shall I? Okay. Is that a deal? Christmas Day, I'll tell the story of St. Nicholas, who we know as Santa Claus. Okay. Okay, that'll be nice. I'll prepare that story for us, guys, for Christmas Day. Okay, we're going to say a prayer. So let's pray. Thank you, God, for Christmas time, for families and friends and people who love us. Thank you, God, for Christmas trees and decorations and shiny lights that remind us that you are always here. Thank you, God, for presents and for your saints who give us gifts. Thank you for love that reaches all of us. And thank you for us, that we get to be here at church again after so long. Thank you for church and for belonging to your family. Amen. Now, we're going to sing three songs. Grown-ups, you're allowed to sit up or stand up or sit down as you choose. We're going to sing Little Donkey. Then we're going to sing Away in a Manger, and then we're going to sing Silent Night. So I think you might know some of those words. So we're going to stay here and sing together. And if you don't know the words, you just hum. We're going to sing together. Okay? Thanks, Peter. We're going to stand. Yeah. Okay. We're going to sing here. You want to sing Away in a Manger in the first verse yourselves? Okay. Sorry, we've just had a suggestion. When we get to Away in a Manger, the children are going to sing the first verse on their own. Okay. So I'm so grateful to the children. Right. Let's go. Sorry, Peter. Move on to Away in a Manger, and the children are going to sing the first verse. Okay, I'll sing with you.
Oh,
last verse. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, children. They're going upstairs. And we're going to stay here. See you just now, guys, for communion. It is so lovely to have the children. Can I do a little bit of theology around children in church just for a moment? You'll never hear me clapping for children. Can I tell you why? They weren't doing anything for you. They were leading us in worship. So unless you're clapping for me after my sermons every week, which I hope you're not, they're leading us. They're part of us. And equally, I'll never ask mothers with babies to go to a cry room. Your baby is welcome to make a noise in church because they're part of us. And sometimes I feel like making a noise in church too. I don't, but I feel like it. So you always welcome children in this place. So our scripture readings for today come from the prophecies or the prophets a lot. So our first reading, and I'm reading the readings for you today because our readers roster was not completed. And I haven't sent readings out. I'll do that this week. Malachi chapter 3 from verse 1. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in the days of old and as in former years. Our reading from the New Testament comes from the letter to the Philippians. I love this particular text because it's how I feel about you. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you. Because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now, I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work in you, among you, will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness, how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. Thus far from the epistle. This week in our Advent readings is always John the Baptist week. And I've not really sung the next hymn much in Methodist circles, but when I've been on retreats in Catholic retreat houses at Advent, we always sing this hymn. So here it is today. It's in our hymn book. hymn number 84. On Jordan's bank, the Baptist's cry announces that the Lord is nigh. Awake and hearken, for he brings glad tidings of the King of Kings. Hymn 84. So here is that gospel reading about John the Baptist, Luke chapter 3, reading from verse 1 to 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Asanias, ruler of Abilene. During the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth. And all flesh shall see the salvation of God. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. If you've been following the news this week, it's been a week of debates around travel bans and vaccine inequality and all sorts of things Omicron related, right? And Basil's looking at me like I'm going mad. The reason I'm talking COVID is because this week is the Peace Week in our Advent readings. This week, we're invited to ponder what it means that Christ brings peace. Now, I've spent a lot of time with the children today, so you're going to have to go home and do the thinking. I'm going to give you three things to think about. My first wondering is I wonder if our readings help us to understand what peace really is. I wonder if our readings help us to understand what peace really is. And I'll give you a couple of things that might help you there. I don't think that the peace that is being referred to in the promises of the scriptures and of Advent is the peace that comes for a busy mom like me when I can send the not so little kids away now and just have it's quiet. I think that helps when you can have rest and peace and quiet. But I think the peace that God refers to is much, much more. The promise of the gospel is a promise of a world at peace because everything is just and fair and true and kind. The promise of this season is that when God is close and we live right, then peace flows. And that's why I mentioned vaccine inequality. The mantra from many of the scientists this week has been, until all are vaccinated, none are safe. And so those in wealthy nations can try hoarding their vaccines and keeping themselves okay, but the world will never be safe and at peace until everyone has access to the vaccines. So my question was, I wonder what peace, Advent peace, looks like. I want to suggest it has something to do with righteousness and justice and mercy. And that when Christ comes close, that's what happens. It's called shalom. You'll know the term. It's more than just we're not fighting. It's that everyone gets to live well. That's the promise of this season. Peace. My second wondering is about what gets in the way of peace. Why is the world not at peace right now? What stops us living just and fair and kind and merciful lives? And the simple answer from our texts is sin. Sin is when I try to control my life, my destiny, my things, my safety, my security, my wants, my needs. I'm in charge. And so I try to protect myself. And it's so much easier if I know who the enemy is. This week, and I don't want to oversimplify, I don't have all the facts, but there was the blockade Friday, of the N3, as those who battle with employment, truck drivers who often work under very harsh conditions, protested about foreigners taking their jobs. It's so much easier to feel like I can control my own destiny if I know who to exclude. Sin. The gospel peace comes when all of us can trust that God will give us what we need. That we don't have to hold on our own. And that's not so easy. And so I wonder if there is any way this Christmas that God may be inviting you to consider living more justly. Is there anything you can do this Christmas to bring peace in this world at this time? How can I live more justly with other people in my community, more kindly, more mercifully? How can I live more justly with creation? Is there something I can do to help people in my neighborhood, in our community, to live well? Is there something I need to notice about my living that distorts peace? John the Baptist used that passage from Isaiah, or that passage from Isaiah was used about John the Baptist, that making the way straight Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain shall be made low, so that everyone can walk easily. What if our Advent this year, we each did something to make it a little easier for someone else? I wonder what that would look like if this year each of us did just one little thing to make it a little easier for someone else. I wonder if there would be peace. I wonder. Let's pray. And I invite you to pray for those who today are unhappy. Maybe even those who are angry. Maybe you want to pray for those who feel that the world is leaving them behind and they don't know what to do to find a way to live. Perhaps you want to pray for those who this Christmas are missing someone they love. Maybe you want to pray for those for whom a Christmas celebration seems out of reach, those who can't get to family, those who don't have jobs and therefore don't know what they will eat today, let alone a Christmas celebration, those who are tired or afraid. And let's pray for each other. Be conscious of the people around you in this place. So many joys and challenges not seen, not known. Help us to live justly and kindly and mercifully with each other, we pray. Gentle Christ. Amen. Table is the place where we are all the same. The table of communion is a place where everyone is welcome. No one is excluded. In the Methodist Church, everyone is welcome here. If you don't have communion elements with you now, if you want to just let us know so that we can get some to you. And then I'm going to ask that someone tip-tap up to the top to tell the children that it's time for communion and that they can come and join us when they're ready, if you'll just go and share that with them. So let us get ready for communion. As we do that, we're going to bring forward the offering. That's what Peter was trying to remind me. We're going to bring forward the offering. If you haven't put in your offering and you want the plate to be held out for you, please just let us know. Just bring the offering forward. And we'll sing the doxology while we do that. Money that you have blessed us with, bread and wine that we might share at your table. May a peaceful and just community be realized in this place, we pray. Amen. So if you want to stay standing,
we come to the table. We come to the Lord's table. We thank and praise you, O God, for you are not distant and uninvolved in our lives and our world, but you have come to us humbly and gently, challengingly and irresistibly. So we remember Jesus' birth and life, his suffering and victory. On the night before his crucifixion, Jesus shared his last meal with his friends. He took the loaf of bread and blessed it. Then breaking it, he offered it to them, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Eat this in memory of me." After the meal, he took the cup of wine and blessed it. Then he offered it to them, saying, "This is my blood shed for you. Drink this in memory of me." You welcome, children. Come in and find your families. Come in and find those you came with. Remind you that in this church, children receive communion because they are part of God's family. So, Lord, we eat and we drink and we remember with hope and joy in the new life which comes in God's kingdom. Amen. God of grace, let's say this part together. God of grace, come to us again in this meal as we share in this bread and wine. May we share in Christ's body and blood. May we offer ourselves to you again, and may we become one with Christ and with each other, a single, unified body. Amen. Please be seated, and we share in communion the body of Christ broken for us. And the blood of Christ shed for us. You shall call him Emmanuel, God with us. Christ is here with us. Go in peace to live and work to God's praise and glory. We thank you, Lord God, for breaking into our world, our lives, and our experience. We thank you, O Christ, for this meal of remembering, the stories of love and grace that it tells. We thank you, O Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. We are a people of peace. We are nourished by Christ. Let's go out and change the world. Each one of us, one moment at a time. Come, thou long-expected Jesus, born to set thy people free, from our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee.
People free from our fears and sins release.
friends, we go into an unknown week. May God go with us as we travel through these days. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Just before we sing, we will be in person services as long as we can be. So we will be here. If we need to go online because of regulations, we will do that. But know that we are here. Wear your masks. If you're not vaccinated, our church highly recommends, I talk the Methodist Church, that you get vaccinated. It helps protect all of us. It's a justice thing. If you want to chat it through, you're welcome. But let's take care of each other. Now we sing.